Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Pope Francis and the Transformation of Healthcare Ethics by Todd A. Salzman and Michael G. Lawler, narrated by Tom Parks. Introduction. Overview of the Ethical and Religious Directives for Catholic Healthcare Services. In June 2018, the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops, USCCB, released the sixth edition of the Ethical and Religious Directives for Catholic Healthcare Services, ERD. We present a critical commentary on the revised ERD focusing on two events. One that should be clearly evident in any revision of the ERD that the USCCB would issue. The other more subtle, but profoundly impacting the entire church and the authority, authenticity, and credibility of the bishops individually and collectively. The first event is Pope Francis's papacy, which began on March 13, 2013, 5 years before the revised ERD was published. Francis has fundamentally transformed Catholic anthropology, ecclesiology, and ethical methodology. Yet there is no evidence of this transformation in the revised ERD. We are guided by the transformative impact of Francis's papacy throughout this commentary, and demonstrate how it should impact future revisions of the ERD in particular, and Catholic healthcare ethics in general. The second event is the clerical sex abuse scandal. While the scandal was covered up by some bishops, it has fundamentally transformed the authority, credibility, and authenticity of all bishops. The revised ERD provides no evidence that the USCCB grasps the impact of this crisis on bishops and the church's authority and credibility. It continues to emphasize the bishop's authority over health care decisions in his diocese as if his authority and credibility are fully intact and untarnished. We address this issue in detail in Chapter 6. The first edition of the ERD was published in 1948 with several subsequent revisions. As science and technology advance, healthcare delivery becomes more complex. Cooperation between Catholic and non-Catholic healthcare providers further complicates it and raises moral questions on the role and function of institutional Catholic mission and identity. The 2018 edition of the ERD is virtually the same as the fifth edition, with the exception of Part 6, which has substantial revisions guiding collaborative arrangements with other healthcare organizations and providers. The ERD seeks to provide ethical guidelines grounded in the natural moral law, church teaching, or canon law to guide Catholic institutions in the provision of health care that reflects both the healing ministry of Jesus and His church's understanding of human dignity. Since its first edition, numerous academic and pastoral articles have been written on the ERD. But there has not been a recent book-length commentary analyzing its directives. The closest scholarly works reflecting such a commentary are a series of five booklets written by Gerald Kelly between 1949 and 1955 titled Medico-Moral Problems, a revisionist proposal by Richard McCormick in 1984, and a manual-type commentary by Orville Greasy in 1987. The essays from Kelly's booklets were arranged topically to follow the sequence of directives in the second and revised edition of the ERD and published in 1958. Kelly was largely responsible for authoring the 1949 and 1956 editions of the ERD, and his booklets are more an explanation of the directives than a critical analysis. McCormick's text is a commentary on Ethical Guidelines for Catholic Healthcare Institutions, itself a proposal by Catholic theologians, healthcare professionals, and ethicists who responded to the invitation from the 1971 Ethical and Religious Directives for Catholic Health Facilities to revise the ERD in light of scientific and theological developments. McCormick's text focuses on anthropological, ethical, methodological, and ecclesiological developments at the Second Vatican Council and its aftermath that mark a fundamental transition in Catholic theological ethics. Greasy began his text with a helpful historical overview of the ERD and focused on 9 principles that explain and justify the directives and provide a manualistic guide to pastoral and moral practices in Catholic hospitals. We believe it is important to contribute a critical analysis of the most recent edition of the ERD, which is in large part a repetition of the 2001 and 2009 editions, for several reasons. We find the 2018 edition of the ERD problematic anthropologically, methodologically, ecclesiologically, and pastorally, as well as specifically in its attempt to navigate mergers between Catholic and non-Catholic institutions. Anthropologically, it continues to prioritize a biological over a relational ontology as the foundation for its norms and principles guiding healthcare, despite the relational shift in Catholic theological ethics since the Second Vatican Council. Methodologically, it has not incorporated recent developments in Catholic theological ethics that have shifted from an act-centered to a virtue-centered method. The focus in the ERD, especially with respect to the beginning and the end of life, continues to be on absolute norms that prescribe particular acts. There is also a deficit in the consideration of Catholic social teaching and its integration with Catholic sexual teaching. The broadening of Catholic social teaching and its concerns with race, immigration, refugees, economics, global health, and artificial intelligence evidence the too narrow vision of the ERD and the need to expand it to address the issues and complexity of healthcare ethics thoughtfully and comprehensively. Catholic social and sexual teachings reflect very different methodologies that demand integration in healthcare ethics. Ecclesiologically, past editions of the ERD focus on patient, physician, and institutional obedience to magisterial teaching and on the authority of local bishops to make decisions regarding the interpretation and application of the ERD. The 6th edition strengthens the role of the local bishop in making those decisions. We believe the emphases on the authority of and obedience to the local bishop raise some important ecclesiological questions. First, the emphasis in the ERD is on the local bishop and his authority in his diocese. The bishop certainly does have teaching authority ecclesially and canonically. But how this authority is exercised in healthcare ethics, policy, and delivery raises ecclesiological concerns. The authority of the bishop emphasized in the ERD too often represents a pre-Second Vatican Council hierarchical ecclesiology that the Council replaced with a communion ecclesiology. There is a very narrow recognition of a communion ecclesiology in the ERD. Its perspective is guided predominantly by a hierarchical ecclesiology. Second, there is no consideration of or appreciation for the sensus fidelium as an essential dimension of a communion ecclesiology in the ERD. This is a betrayal of Catholic tradition and the ecclesiological vision of the Second Vatican Council. Third, there is no acknowledgement of the sex abuse crisis or its impact on episcopal authority, credibility, and authenticity individually and collectively. We shall deal with communion ecclesiology and sensus fidelium in some detail in Chapter 4, and the implications of the sex abuse crisis for the ERD in Chapter 6. In addition, the ERD offers little that is of help to persons seeking to understand the importance and centrality of pastoral/spiritual care in Catholic health care. Jean DeBlois appeals to the bishops to read The Signs of the Times Regarding the State of Catholic Health Care and to respond in a deeper and more spiritual way to people's needs. The signs today are remarkably similar to, but more complex than the signs she was reading in 2009. Religious and ethical pluralism, political, religious, cultural, and moral polarization, economic challenges, especially for the uninsured and underinsured, and the challenges of delivering health care in light of the immigration crisis, which itself begs for compassionate care and redress. These considerations, combined with the reality of a priest shortage and lack of serious theological training for pastoral ministers, demand ecclesial, pastoral, moral, and perhaps even canonical responses. Finally, in terms of collaboration and mergers between Catholic and non-Catholic institutions, there is a broader ecclesiological issue within the Church in general, and the ERD in particular, on how to resolve conflicts between bishops if and when there are disagreements between them on collaboration between Catholic and non-Catholic healthcare institutions that span across multiple dioceses. As healthcare delivery becomes more complex and non-Catholic organizations merge with Catholic ones and expand across dioceses and states, there will inevitably continue to be disagreements between bishops about how to interpret and apply the ERD in general and the principles of legitimate cooperation in specific. The acknowledgement of such disagreements and criteria for resolving them are vague, both in the ERD and in canon law. We propose throughout this commentary that the Catholic way to reconcile such disagreements and differences is the way of dialogue and charity recommended by Popes John Paul II and Francis. Listen, Francis advises, keep an open mind. Don't get bogged down in your own limited ideas and opinions, but be prepared to change or expand them. The combination of two different ways of thinking can lead to a synthesis that enriches both. The unity we seek is not a uniformity, but a unity in diversity. He goes on in a church communion perspective, teaching that fraternal communion is enriched by respect and appreciation for differences within an overall perspective that advances the common good. His advice should be followed by bishops who disagree about the interpretation and application of the ERD, and by all Catholics, as we shall hear, who disagree about doctrinal or moral issues. Disagreements between bishops and how their authority is to be exercised in disputed moral health care issues is not adequately treated in the 2018 revised ERD. The anthropological, methodological, and ecclesiological issues evident in the 2018 edition of the ERD, as well as the challenges of pastoral/spiritual ministry and collaboration between Catholic and non-Catholic institutions, have a historical basis reflected in the evolution of the ERD itself. We explore that history, provide an overview of the contents of the current ERD, and introduce the most basic meta-ethical question of ethical discourse to begin our critical analysis of the ERD. Is there such a thing as ethical truth? A brief historical overview of the ERD. There is a long history of Catholic concern for the care and treatment of the sick and infirm, grounded in Jesus' healing ministry. Catholics believe that Jesus of Nazareth is God incarnate in the world, and thus he is the way, the truth, and the life to the Father. John chapter 14, verse 6. When they read the gospel accounts of Jesus' life, they discover that he was both a teacher and a renowned healer, and that he passed on this double mission to his apostles, sending them out to preach the kingdom of God and to heal. Luke chapter 9, verses 1 through 2. This mission to preach and to heal is one of the foundations of Catholic healthcare ministry, and concern about it became more pronounced and deliberate in the 16th century and continues to evolve over time. Issues such as how to determine death and which procedures were necessary or optional to prolong life were often discussed. No formal guidelines were issued early on, but priest theologians did develop general norms for the care and treatment of patients. As Catholic religious communities began to focus more on health care, and Catholic hospitals became more prevalent in the late 19th and early 20th centuries in Canada and the United States, there was a recognized need for the systematic formulation of norms and guidelines for both Catholic healthcare practitioners and institutions to ensure effective patient care and to protect the rights of Catholic hospitals and healthcare facilities. To those ends, the Catholic Hospital Association, CHA, later named the Catholic Health Association, was established in 1915. The CHA recognized the importance of issuing guidelines to address difficult moral issues in the delivery of health care. The first set of guidelines was formulated by Michael Burke for the Archdiocese of Detroit in 1921 and focused on surgical procedures such as direct sterilization or destruction of fetal life. This was a one-page list of norms that was modified in some cases and posted on the walls of operating rooms in many U.S. and Canadian Catholic hospitals. The rule-oriented guidelines stated the do's and don'ts of surgical procedures deemed most controversial at the time, but offered no theological foundation. As healthcare evolved and the moral issues involved in its delivery became more complex, there was a recognized need for standardizing the guidelines and articulating a foundation and structure to justify them. Theologians and healthcare professionals began work on this project in 1947, and in 1948, the Ethical and Religious Directives for Catholic Hospitals, ERD, was published. It was not a mandatory code for Catholic hospitals to follow, but its adoption was subject to the discretion of the local bishop. Many bishops in Canada and the United States did adopt it. After World War II, Canada instituted universal health care, and since this system had a very different form of delivery, with distinct ethical issues from the United States, Canadian hospitals, under the supervision of the Canadian bishops, thereafter established their own Catholic Healthcare Association. In 1954, the Canadian bishops adopted the Code of Ethical Directives for Catholic hospitals in their dioceses. In the United States, the ERD was revised and expanded in 1956 to make it more accessible to Catholic hospitals and healthcare practitioners. The revision sought both to be more systematic and user-friendly, including an index and reference material, and to address broader issues like professional confidentiality, pastoral and spiritual ministry to non-Catholics, and psychological treatment. Jesuit moral theologian Gerald Kelly was the principal author of the 1949 and 1956 directives. He published a number of articles explaining and commenting on the directives in the journal Hospital Progress, now Health Progress, which were collected and later published in the first comprehensive commentary on the ERD. The various editions of the ERD were published to give clear moral guidelines and consistent interpretation of those guidelines for Catholic healthcare facilities. It continued to be acknowledged that the local bishop was ultimately responsible for its adoption, interpretation, and application. Interpretation of the ERD was rather uniform in the 1950s and early 1960s. But with the development of the new ethical method of proportionalism among Catholic moral theologians, the directives began to be interpreted divergently on issues such as contraception and sterilization, depending on whether the local bishop was progressive or conservative. Proportionalism is an ethical method that discerns the pre-moral values and disvalues of an act to judge whether the pre-moral value can justify causing the pre-moral disvalue in any given act. Proportionate reason is used to facilitate this judgment. Progressive bishops recognized the contribution of this principle, which is established in Catholic tradition and frequently cited in the ERD itself, especially on end-of-life treatment decisions to guide healthcare professionals and patients in making responsible ethical decisions. Conservative bishops used the principle of proportionate reason in end-of-life issues to determine the benefits and burdens of treatment, but they rejected its relevance on other issues, such as contraception and sterilization. Different episcopal interpretations of the ERD led to what we may call geographical morality, morality that depends on the location of the hospital and of the bishop interpreting the ERD. These different interpretations point to different methodological perspectives that have profound implications for the interpretation and application of the ERD, depending on whether a bishop is conservative or progressive. The tension is amplified, as we discuss in detail in Chapter 7, by Catholic and non-Catholic mergers that span several dioceses where there are several Catholic hospitals, like those owned by Catholic Health Initiative, and different diocesan bishops who oversee the hospitals and the interpretation and application of the ERD within them. In response to geographical morality and to standardize the interpretation and application of the ERD, the CHA Board of Trustees requested the National Conference of Catholic Bishops, NCCB, now the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops, to formulate and promulgate a uniform set of ERD for the United States. Such a standardization, CHA hoped, would eliminate geographical morality. In 1971, a new ERD was published with overwhelming support from the bishops, though many theologians had theological and ethical concerns. The 1971 ERD was legalistic in its approach and did not offer any theological rationale or justification for its directives, merely stating them as rules to be followed. As we shall hear, there were and are anthropological and methodological tensions in the ERD when comparing different directives. There was, however, a sense of urgency for the bishops to promulgate this edition of the ERD before the coming U.S. Supreme Court ruling on Roe v. Wade, 1973, which legalized abortion, and injunctions by federal courts rejecting prohibitions of sterilizations in Catholic hospitals. Cardinal John Kroll of Philadelphia, president of the NCCB at the time, pushed for adoption of the ERD by bishops throughout the United States so that they would be on record as forbidding these and other procedures judged to violate religious teaching. It was believed that the Federal Conscience Clause would protect Catholic healthcare facilities and professionals when they refused to perform these procedures. The new ERD did not eliminate the threat of geographical morality, especially on issues like sterilization, to prevent a future pathology. The legalistic nature of the 1971 ERD and the lack of methodological and theological justification for it, as well as emerging moral issues such as the need for informed consent for research subjects, led to another revision of the ERD. Taking advice from theologians, moralists, medical practitioners, and its own Committee on Doctrine, the NCCB approved a Revised Ethical and Religious Directives for Catholic Healthcare Services in 1994. This edition had six sections with several significant developments. First, it expanded beyond medical ethics to include issues of social justice. Catholic moral theology, has a long-noted methodological and normative division between biomedical and sexual ethics on the one hand and social ethics on the other. Catholic social teaching formulates principles, such as the common good, for example, that allow for interpretation and application. Catholic sexual teaching and biomedical ethics often consist of absolute, one-size-fits-all norms, regardless of context and circumstances, and applicable always and everywhere, such as the prohibition of artificial contraception and direct sterilization. The 1994 ERD recognizes that social justice is a central consideration in healthcare ethics and provides a complement to, and perhaps we will argue a corrective for, some absolute healthcare and sexual norms. In his Amoris Laetitia, Pope Francis proposes new pastoral methods for approaching moral issues surrounding marriage and family, and demonstrates an integration of Catholic social and sexual teaching that could serve as an important addition to future revised editions of the ERD. Second, rather than presenting a more positive approach to Catholic identity, previous editions of the ERD emphasized a series of negative prohibitions of what Catholic hospitals and healthcare professionals cannot do. The 1994 ERD intended to create a culture dedicated to promoting human dignity in a way that was animated by the spirit of the gospel and guided by the teachings of the church. Third, it expands its treatment of clinical issues to include advanced directives, reproductive technologies, and artificial nutrition and hydration, and offers theological justification for its ethical conclusions. We argue that this theological justification is insufficient, given the Church's deficient anthropology and methodology to justify its teachings. Fourth, in tune with the merger of Catholic and non-Catholic facilities, this edition provides guidelines for the shifting paradigm of delivery systems. The basic question here is if and how Catholic hospitals maintain their Catholic mission, identity, and culture when they partner with non-Catholic providers. This challenge is exacerbated today when such partnerships are essential for the very survival of Catholic healthcare institutions. Each section of the 1994 ERD contains an explanation of the theological foundation for the specific directives in that section. There is also an appendix explaining the principle of cooperation in evil that was especially relevant in a time of mergers between Catholic and non-Catholic healthcare institutions. The Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith, CDF, reviewed the ERD before the bishops voted to adopt them, but it had not reviewed the appendix on the principle of cooperation, one of the most difficult principles in Catholic moral theology to understand and apply. The appendix is a truncated explanation of this principle, and it raised concerns about interpretation among both bishops and moral theologians. In 2000, the CDF required the NCCB to review the appendix since it was open to misinterpretation and misapplication. The appendix was dropped in the 2001 edition, and all the revisions from the 1994 edition occur in Part 6, forming new partnerships with healthcare organizations and providers. Jesuit Kevin Wildes notes two important paradigm shifts in the 1994 directives. First, there is an ecclesiological shift, a move away from a unity in plurality model of the Church, already reflected in different spiritualities and ministries in the Church, such as those of the Jesuits and Dominicans, to a hierarchical uniformity, in which the bishop is the sole arbiter for the interpretation and application of the ERD. This hierarchical dimension, as we shall hear, has been expanded in the 2018 edition of the ERD. And in complex healthcare mergers that cross diocesan boundaries, may pit one bishop's interpretation of the ERD against another's. Second, there is a methodological shift from different ethical methods for discerning complex ethical issues guided by personal conscience and prudence, teleology, casuistry, and virtue ethics, for instance, to a largely deontological, rule-based absolutist approach that too often ignores the complexity of the issues and removes the prudential judgment of conscience from the process by deductively imposing and demanding obedience to universal rules. The ERD was revised again in 2001, and Kevin O'Rourke, Thomas Kopfensteiner, and Ronald Hamill note four significant changes in that edition. First, Directive 70 was added, forbidding immediate material cooperation with an intrinsically evil action, such as direct sterilization. Second, a footnote on Directive 70 stated that it supersedes the NCCB's 1977 commentary on the 1975 CDF document, Quaecumque Sterilizatio. The NCCB commentary agreed with the CDF that preventive sterilizations were direct and could never be performed in Catholic hospitals. But it allowed for direct sterilizations on the basis of immediate material cooperation due to duress or fear that a Catholic hospital would close if it did not perform direct sterilizations. Third, the appendix on the principle of cooperation was deleted since its different interpretations and applications caused disagreement and confusion. Fourth, the concept of scandal, as it is used in the principle of cooperation, is more precisely defined following the Catechism of the Catholic Church's definition: an attitude or behavior which leads another to do evil. Scandal is a grave offense if by deed or omission another is deliberately led into a grave offense. It is clear that scandal is a serious issue and something to be avoided. But what is not clear or defined is what constitutes scandal and how claims of scandal are to be justified. The ERD claims that scandal is caused when there are violations of the ERD due to immediate material cooperation in wrongdoings, such as the distribution of contraceptives. Scandal, however, can depend on which teaching of the Catholic Church is emphasized. In response to President Barack Obama's Affordable Care Act, ACA, for example, the USCCB protested against its contraceptive mandate that requires healthcare facilities to provide contraceptives to those who request them, arguing that such a mandate was a violation of Directive 52 and might lead people to believe that Catholic healthcare facilities condone contraceptive practices, which caused scandal by leading others to believe that contraceptive use is morally acceptable. Others, however, focus on Catholic teaching on the authority and inviolability of a well-informed conscience, that human dignity demands the right to follow one's conscience, and that access to health care is a basic human right. Scandal can be very much in the eye of the beholder, and we ask, which claim of scandal is justified in a given situation? The assertion that an action would cause scandal is precisely that, an assertion, not a moral argument, and like any assertion of right or wrong, it must be justified by sound moral argument. Given the weaknesses of the Church's arguments against contraception and the vast majority of Catholics who do not accept the argument, scandal is just as likely to be caused by the USCCB's opposition to the ACA's contraceptive mandate as by permitting the distribution of contraceptives by Catholic healthcare institutions to adult patients following an informed and responsible conscience. The 2009 fifth edition is, for the most part, a repetition of the 1994 and slightly revised 2001 editions, with one notable exception, Directive 58. This directive is revised in light of Pope John Paul II's address on life-sustaining treatments and vegetative state, and addresses in detail artificial nutrition and hydration for dying patients. We address this revised directive in detail in Chapter 1. Brief overview and analysis of the 2018 ERD. The most recent 2018 sixth edition of the ERD is identical to the 2009 fifth edition, with the exception of Part 6, where there are substantial revisions. We will treat these revisions in detail in Chapter 6. Briefly, the revisions focus on collaborative arrangements between Catholic and non-Catholic institutions, the importance and explanation of the principles guiding formal and material cooperation, the importance of avoiding scandal in collaborative arrangements, references to canon law, and the significance of Catholic healthcare institutions as witnesses to Catholic identity as tools for assessing collaborative arrangements. There is an emphasis on the authority of the local bishop to interpret and apply the ERD, and a greater emphasis on centralizing this authority. The ultimate responsibility for the interpretation and application of the directive rests with the diocesan bishop. In a sense, this continues the emphasis on hierarchical centralization that Wilds notes in the 1994 edition, but it ignores the communion ecclesiology mandated by the Second Vatican Council, which we deal with in Chapter 4. It also seems to ignore the cultural and economic shifts in healthcare delivery that exist in partnerships that cross diocesan boundaries, and that may include multiple bishops in the interpretation and application of the ERD. The sixth edition takes no account of differences between bishops in their interpretation and application of the ERD and of how to resolve those differences. The general structure of the edition is as follows: a preamble, general introduction, six parts treating various topics and issues, and a brief conclusion. Preamble. The preamble begins by noting that healthcare in the United States is subject to extraordinary change. Change is manifest in technological advances. Institutional and social factors that include the changing demographics of Catholic healthcare employees due to the declining number of religious, social, and cultural pluralism, delivery and collaborative arrangements in healthcare, and developments in Catholic moral theology since the Second Vatican Council. All of these changes present challenges to moralists, healthcare personnel, and bishops who are to interpret and apply the ERD. Methodologically, the preamble mentions the aid of other sciences over the centuries to develop numerous moral principles that constitute the ERD. We will address this point in detail in Chapter 3. The ERD states two purposes. First, to reaffirm the ethical standards of behavior in healthcare that flow from the Church's teaching about the dignity of the human person. Second, to provide authoritative guidance on certain moral issues that face Catholic healthcare today. It then lays out the structure of the ERD, which consists of six parts divided into two sections. The first section is expository. It serves as an introduction and provides the context in which concrete issues can be discussed from the perspective of the Catholic faith. The second section is prescriptive. Directives promote and protect the truths of the Catholic faith as those truths are brought to bear on concrete issues in healthcare. General Introduction. The foundation of the ERD is Jesus' healing ministry testified to in the Gospels and continued in history in the Church's compassionate healthcare ministry. The introduction makes several important points on ecclesiology and methodology. First, commentaries on the revised ERD note a focus on emphasizing the local bishop's authority to interpret and apply the ERD and to promote collaboration among healthcare leaders, employees, ministers, theologians, approved authors, and specialists. The bishop is to serve as pastor, teacher, and priest. As pastor, he promotes and encourages the faithful to participate in the church's healing ministry. As teacher, he ensures the religious and moral identity of healthcare ministries throughout the diocese. As priest, he ensures sacramental care for the sick. Methodologically, the ERD draws from the four sources of ethical knowledge, scripture, tradition, reason, and experience to justify its principles that facilitate protecting and attaining human dignity. It emphasizes the importance of dialogue between science and faith, and the importance of a correct conscience based on the moral norms for proper health care. There is some overlap in the introduction between the ecclesiological and methodological considerations. The bishop has the final say on how the ERD is to be interpreted and applied. When an issue arises where the magisterium has not offered a determinative answer, the guidance of approved authors can offer appropriate guidance for ethical decision-making. Conscience, which we deal with in detail in chapters 2 and 6, is mentioned without explanation only in the final sentence of the introduction. Each person, it states, must form a correct conscience based on the moral norms for proper health care. These moral norms are defined by the magisterium and interpreted by the bishop and his approved authors. There is a clear ecclesiological and methodological hierarchy in the ERD. The local bishop has ultimate authority on both the authoritative interpretation and application of the ERD and the determination of the approved authors to guide him in making his authoritative judgment. The hierarchy of the four sources of ethical knowledge are established as follows. Tradition, narrowly defined as magisterial teaching and the authority of the local bishop to interpret and apply those teachings. Scripture, as interpreted by the magisterium. Reason, that conforms to magisterial teaching, and experience. There is no mention of a traditional and essential source of ethical knowledge, namely the sensus fidelium. Experience is mentioned twice in the entire ERD. The first is in reference to patients experiencing human dignity, and the second is in reference to the experience of healthcare professionals to pursue healing, to maintain health, and to provide compassionate care. Six parts. The body of the ERD is divided into six parts, each of which includes an introduction and specific directives. Part 1, the social responsibility of Catholic healthcare services, is spelled out in 5 points. First, Catholic healthcare ministry is committed to promoting and defending human dignity, which is foundational to Catholic moral teaching and to the ERD. The concept of human dignity grounds a theological anthropology, which we explore in detail in Chapter 2, and which is foundational for formulating and justifying specific directives that facilitate and do not frustrate human dignity. Second, there is an emphasis on the biblical mandate to care for the poor, the uninsured and underinsured, children and the unborn, single parents, the elderly, those with incurable diseases and chemical dependencies, racial minorities, immigrants, and refugees. We could surely add the underpaid, the unemployed, and the homeless to that list. Third, Catholic healthcare ministry is committed to realizing the common good. Economic, political, and social conditions that ensure protection for the fundamental right of all individuals and enable all to fulfill their common purpose and reach their common goals. Fourth, Catholic healthcare ministry must practice responsible stewardship and the responsible use and distribution of limited resources. Discernment of the use of resources is guided by the principle of subsidiarity or participatory justice, which includes dialogue with anyone who seeks to participate but especially those, including the most vulnerable, who are directly affected by resource distribution. Fifth, Part 1 recognizes that, in a pluralist society, individuals may request medical procedures that are contrary to the moral teachings of the Church, and asserts that denying those requests does not offend the individual conscience. We explore the interrelationship between the authority of magisterial teaching and the authority of individual conscience in Chapter 2. Part 2, The Pastoral and Spiritual Responsibility of Catholic Healthcare, emphasizes human dignity and that each and every person created in the image of God, Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, shares in that dignity. The physical dimension is central to the care and treatment of every patient, but the ERD emphasizes holistic care of the person physically, psychologically, socially, and spiritually. Without health of the spirit, high technology focused strictly on the body offers limited hope for healing the whole person. Pastoral care is an essential component of Catholic health care and the healing process, and must provide for the spiritual needs of the patient. Priests, deacons, religious, lay chaplains, and all Catholic health care personnel act in complementary ways to provide pastoral care through healing ministry. In this part, the ERD employs a holistic anthropology, recognizing that the person is an integrated being physically, psychologically, spiritually, and relationally. We have two preliminary comments on Part 2. First, this holistic anthropology is inconsistently recognized when it comes to specific directives, especially with respect to sexual ethical issues and the beginning and end of life. Second, as Sister Jean de Blois comments, the section on pastoral and spiritual care is woefully inadequate. We address these points in Chapter 1 and Chapter 5, respectively. Part 3, The Professional-Patient Relationship, explains and promotes a truly interpersonal professional-patient relationship. Healthcare professionals must provide professionally competent and compassionate care, informing patients about their healthcare issues and guiding them to maintain or restore health, taking into account the patient's convictions, values, and spiritual needs. Patients depend on healthcare providers to promote the holistic health of body, mind, and spirit, and to restore health or preserve life. Patients are responsible for using these resources to realize holistic health in light of their spiritual and moral commitments. Patient autonomy and healthcare recommendations are limited in the patient-physician relationship by the Catholic identity of the institution, which trumps patient autonomy and recommended medical practice. The ERD summarizes the interrelationship between the patient, healthcare professional, and the Catholic institution. When the healthcare professional and the patient use institutional Catholic healthcare, they also accept its public commitment to the Church's understanding of and witness to the dignity of the human person. The interrelationship between patient, physician, and the identity of the Catholic institution raises several questions. First, through its directives guiding the patient-physician relationship and teachings regarding specific ethical issues, the Church posits a theological anthropology or definition of human dignity and what facilitates and does not frustrate human dignity. This theological anthropology, as we show, is not always consistent. Second, there is a question of moral agency and who has the right and authority to decide and on what criteria. At times, the patient, the healthcare professional, or the Catholic institution has that authority. Third, related to the question of authority, what is the relationship between the conscience of the patient, the healthcare provider, and the Catholic institution? Which voice should have authority? And what are the criteria for making that determination? We attempt to respond to those questions as we proceed. Part 4, Issues in Care for the Beginning of Life, notes that Catholic health care emphasizes the sanctity of life from the moment of conception until death. It focuses on sexual intercourse in marriage and addresses two ethical issues related to it, contraception and reproductive technologies. It quotes Gaudium et Spes to explain the mutual self-giving and procreative meaning of conjugal love. And it quotes Humanae Vitae to emphasize the unitive and procreative meanings of sexual intercourse. It recognizes responsible parenthood that allows a married couple to limit the number of children by natural means, and follows Humanae Vitae in prohibiting contraceptive interventions. It then claims that reproductive technologies, which substitute for the marital act, violate human dignity. It summarizes, just as the marriage act is joined naturally to procreation, so procreation is joined to the marriage act. There are several points to make regarding the introduction to Part 4. First, it fails to acknowledge Pope Francis's recent statements on marriage and the family, that natural methods of fertility regulation are to be promoted. This is very different from Humanae Vitae's and the ERD's absolute condemnation of contraception, which is nowhere quoted in Amoris Laetitia. Second, Pope Francis notes that the married couple should make any decision about fertility regulation in conscience before God. Here and elsewhere, Francis reinstitutes the authority and inviolability of conscience, which the ERD consistently fails to recognize. Third, the ERD employs a sexual anthropology that prioritizes the biological over the relational, psychological, and spiritual dimensions of human sexuality. The focus is entirely on the conjugal act of intercourse and its procreative meaning, not on its relational meaning. It states, with no supporting evidence aside from the Church's interpretation of natural law, that contraception and reproductive technologies are destructive of human dignity, and imposes this vision on all married couples. We address the anthropological and methodological issues raised in Part 4 in Chapters 2 and 3, respectively. Part 5, Issues in Care for the Seriously Ill and Dying, begins by emphasizing Christ's redemptive and saving grace, which is present and active at all times, including when a person is facing sickness, suffering, and death. This part emphasizes the virtues of faith, hope, and humility when facing suffering and death, the virtue of prudence when making end-of-life decisions on what is ordinary and proportionate care, and what is burdensome and disproportionate care, and the assurance that Catholic health care will be a community of love, support, and respect. Euthanasia and physician-assisted suicide are absolutely prohibited, but a patient may in good conscience forego disproportionate or burdensome treatment. The ERD includes numerous references to the virtues, but the directives often prioritize obedience to church teaching over every other virtue. A particularly challenging issue in Part 5 is the 2009 edition of Directive 58, requiring the use in principle of medically assisted nutrition and hydration for patients in a persistent vegetative state. The challenges for this directive, as we shall hear, relate to moral agency. Who decides? What are the criteria for that decision, and how is the decision made? Part 6, Collaborative Arrangements with Other Healthcare Organizations and Providers, includes the only substantial changes from the 5th edition, and is crucial to navigating the ongoing complex social, cultural, economic, and contextual dimensions of collaborative healthcare delivery. The introduction to this section is unique in that it explains in some detail the principles of legitimate material and formal cooperation as the foundational principles guiding collaborative relationships. These principles were first included in the appendix in the 1994 edition of the ERD. But that appendix was dropped in the 2001 and 2009 editions because experience has shown that the brief articulation of the principles of cooperation that was presented there did not sufficiently forestall certain possible misinterpretations, and in practice gave rise to problems in concrete applications of the principles. The principles themselves are still included in the 2001 and 2009 editions, Directives 69 and 70 respectively, with a more expansive explanation of the principles in the 2018 edition. We explore the complexity of understanding, interpreting, and applying these principles in Chapter 6. We note a few important points about Part 6. First, it recognizes that pursuing the common good may require collaboration with institutions that do not operate in conformity with the Church's moral teaching. This is an important point in that it recognizes a hierarchy of values. The common good can be a greater good that justifies collaboration with institutions that do not follow Catholic teaching. It has long been recognized in Catholic moral theology that values can come into conflict and that there must be criteria on principles for resolving any conflict. The ERD often cites proportionate reason as such a principle, determining what benefits can outweigh burdens in end-of-life decisions, for example, or the principles of legitimate cooperation to address questions of collaboration. Second, particular circumstances can help in making this prudential judgment, and they must be taken into account. Circumstances are important since they specifically address context. Prudential judgment means that reasonable people may disagree on how the principle is interpreted and applied in particular collaborative arrangements. Third, Part 6 asserts without adequate explanation that scandal is to be avoided. Fourth, reliable theological experts should be consulted. Fifth, the diocesan bishop is responsible for interpreting and applying the directives and for recruiting reliable experts to help him in his interpretation. This raises the question of collaborative relationships that extend beyond one diocese into another, and how to resolve disagreements between bishops in a particular collaborative relationship or in interpreting and applying the ERD. We address the principles guiding cooperation and the ecclesiological considerations in this analysis and evaluation in Chapters 6 and 4, respectively. Metaethics. We begin our critical analysis of the ERD with the most basic question of ethics. Many people understand ethics to be primarily about what is good or right. But the most fundamental question of ethics is whether the terms good or right have any meaning. If they do not, is there such a thing as ethics? Do ethical terms have meaning against which we can evaluate reality or human experience? Or do they merely express sentiments, feelings, or emotions that contain no criteria for determining their truth or falsity? Until this question is answered, we cannot proceed to the next question in ethics, which is the definition of ethical terms and the formulation and justification of norms for attaining the ethical good. In this section, we first explore the meta-ethical theory of the Catholic tradition, namely, natural law. For the ERD asserts that the moral teachings that we profess here flow principally from the natural law, understood in the light of the revelation Christ has entrusted to His Church. Second, we propose perspectivism as a meta-ethical epistemology that accounts for plural definitions of the good defined as human dignity. Ontology, physicalist or personalist. The classification of ethics that attempts to answer the question of whether or not there is ethical truth, or whether the terms good or right and their opposites have any meaning, is known as metaethics. Meta derives from the Greek meaning to go beyond or transcend. The area of ethics called metaethics attempts to define the very foundation of ethics. It asks the most basic questions of whether there is such a thing as ethical truth, whether ethical terms have meaning, and whether that meaning can be justified. There are two distinct areas in metaethics, ontology and epistemology. Ontology investigates the foundation on which ethical truth is based. Epistemology investigates how we know ethical truth. The Catholic metaethical tradition, grounded in a physical understanding of natural law, claims that we can define the good and that we can justify that definition based on various sources of ethical knowledge. Thomas Aquinas provides the classic Catholic definition of natural law: human participation in eternal law through right reason. Ontologically, natural law posits that God created both the universe and an ethical order to the universe that human beings, through reason, can know and understand. There are at least two understandings of this ontological truth in the Catholic tradition: physicalism and personalism. The first understanding, and the one that predominates in Catholic sexual ethics and much of biomedical ethics, defines the ethical as physical, biological reality, commonly referred to as physicalism. Physicalism emphasizes the biological and physical dimensions of human dignity. Prioritizing the biological and physical dimensions over all other dimensions is ethically right, and violating the biological and physical dimensions is ethically wrong. For example, the physical structure of the sexual act is directed toward reproduction, and to impede or disrupt this physical act, through contraception or sterilization, for example, is a violation of the natural law and is morally wrong. Reproductive-type sexual acts between a married couple are right and moral. Contraceptive sexual acts between a married couple are wrong and immoral, and so are all non-reproductive sexual acts that cannot reach their biological finality. The second understanding of ontological truth focuses on relationship and is often designated as personalism. Personalism defines human dignity in terms of what facilitates interpersonal relationship. What is right facilitates interpersonal relationship, and what is wrong frustrates it. When the focus is on relationship, the answer to the question of whether or not a contraceptive act disrupts the biological finality of the sexual act is not ethically decisive. What is decisive is the answer to the question of how this act affects one's human relationships. If a contraceptive act frustrates relationship, it is morally wrong. If it facilitates relationship, it is morally right. The relational meaning of the act is ethically prioritized over its biological or physical meaning, and the physical act becomes a, not the, dimension of the relationship. Generally speaking, in Catholic theological ethics, it is not an either-or ontology, either physicalism or personalism, but both and. Catholic natural law ethics recognizes the morality of both the biological and the relational. But it is a question of which is to be prioritized on a specific ethical issue and situation. Both Pope John Paul II and many traditionalist moral theologians, and Pope Francis and many revisionist moral theologians, for instance, claim to be personalists. That is, they recognize the human person in relationship as a source of ontological truth. These groups have, however, very different theological anthropologies and definitions of human dignity, and the moral norms that facilitate or frustrate human dignity. Pope John Paul II and traditionalist moral theologians, for instance, maintain that the use of contraceptives always frustrates human dignity, and is, therefore, immoral. Pope Francis and revisionist moral theologians maintain that contraception may be either right or wrong, depending on how it impacts human relationship. What accounts for this normative difference is an ontological prioritization of the relational or physical. John Paul II, in what some label a theology of the body, prioritizes the physical dimension of human dignity as essential and determinative to fulfill the relational dimension. John Finnis, a staunch traditionalist philosopher and defender of church teaching on human sexuality, states this prioritization explicitly. Acts of a reproductive kind are biologically and thus personally or relationally one. In his Human Person Adequately Considered, revisionist moral theologian Louis Jansons prioritizes the relational dimension of human dignity as essential and determinative. The biological or physical being a, but not the determining dimension of human dignity. The ethical implications are clear. For John Paul II and traditionalist moral theologians, contraception by definition frustrates human dignity and damages the marital relationship, disrupting the physical structure of the marital act by separating its procreative and unitive meanings. For Jansons and revisionist moral theologians, contraception may or may not frustrate human dignity, depending on the relational meaning of their sexual intercourse for the spouses. The ontological prioritization of the physical or relational meaning of the sexual act divides the two interpretations of natural law and their definitions of human dignity.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.